Well, quick market update. Oh, meeting in progress. There we go. Now it's recording. Oh, well, welcome everybody. We'll go start it all over again. And how do I get rid of? Hold on 1 second. No, it's all right. And I just fixed this. There we go. Okay. All right. Good. And let's just check this. Slides. Perfect. Okay. We're good to go. All right. So quick market update and give some market projections as well. Always like to do this just again, position you as the expert with all this information, save you a little time. So you don't have to get out there and do all this research yourself. Some of this you may have seen already if you're checking kind of our regular emails that go out, but want to do hit some new points as well. First off in May. So here's all your May stats of what happened in the greater Grand Rapids metro area. We hit a new peak and average sales price at 377. Paul, any guess what our previous peak was? Maybe? No? Jeff? 366 per month basis. So last year in April, actually, we peaked at 359 on an average sales price per month. So all that talk about home prices not holding and everything, we have the data to show that that's just not happening right now. Now that average list to sales price ratio, it's at 104%. So obviously things are still selling over. Now I want to go in a little more detail on that so you understand how that breaks down. Because if you just look at that number, I don't know what gives you the whole story. So 22% of homes still sold below, about 15% sold at, and then 63% sold above. Now I want you to notice at the below, if we were selling below, on average it was selling about 4% below the average sale price or the list price. If it was something that was sold above the list price, on average that was up over 8% higher than the average list price. So when you're thinking about your offers, it's like, oh, this is one I know that's going to go over. That's kind of the baseline. That's where the mid-range, the average of where people are going over in order to get accepted purchase agreements. Now, again, this data is all from closed properties. So that's the best we can do is all month old. So keep that in mind about what you're feeling with the market. And we'll give you some more info on that as well. Kayla, and if you see anybody pop up in the chat, any questions, just let me know. I am not watching it.
James, that info in the email you sent out
yesterday. This would be probably a week ago, this particular one. All right, then also want to just keep on moving down the list. If you look at the number of homes sold in May, 789. Last year, that was just over 1,000. So we are down in the amount of homes sold, as well as when we look at the amount of homes sold year to date, that's down about 16%. And so if we take a look at buyer activity, here's a lot of the reason why. If you take a look at all the way, the orange line is this year, and we're comparing it against the three previous years, and you can see how low that orange line is all the way until we hit about just past that March 27 and just getting into April. You can see where the holidays hit. That's Easter right in there. And then all of a sudden, boom, after Easter, we shot up like crazy. And now our activity from buyers is on par with what we looked at the last couple of years. So what that's resulting in is you take a look at those pending sales. And this is right now, that was the end of May. We're a few weeks into June already, just over 1,100. Any guesses on what we have pending properties right now in the market? Rebecca, any idea? Ooh, you're very close. It was, 1185 when we looked at it. So I'll give you that one. Any guesses? I'll go Nestor. Any guesses on how many pending we had the same time last year? A little bit higher. So last year, so close. Actually, it was pretty much the exact same amount. It was 1189. So the reason why I'm bringing that up is just we're seeing that buyer activity has picked up. And even though inventory is low, We're seeing the same amount of, just right now, we had a really slow start, but now we're seeing pretty much the same amount of activity and pending sales as last year at this time. Good, moving along. Now, inventory has been kind of interesting. And so, because we've talked about how low it is, and it is extremely low, but it's kind of strange how it compares to last year a little bit, especially how it started out. So light blue line was last year, dark blue line is this year, and also what we're projecting moving forward. But you can see we started out actually with quite a bit more inventory this year. We just didn't have quite the buyer activity, right? Like the previous chart that we saw. And that's why sales were slower during the January, February, and March month, but we actually did have more inventory. But now we're not seeing the same ramp up that we saw last spring, right? And we're expecting that to continue throughout the year. So we're going to talk about some things to prepare for that, because we are expecting that inventory to stay lower throughout the year based off of everything we're seeing. And so you can download this chart too. It might be helpful when talking with some folks about what's coming up in the market. All right, so here is what it looks like, average sales price in our area per month. So far this year, you see it ramping up to that 377. John, any guesses on what our pending prices are right now, average pending price? I'll give you guys a hint. It was about 363 last month, and we ended up with homes on average selling at 377. Julie, any idea? No. Pretty close. So we're at 364.4, which is about on par with last month. And so it's about $1,000 more. So, you know, give or take, it's pretty much the same thing. So why do we point this out? Is we're going to take a look at a chart next, is we're really expecting that those prices are going to kind of start to level off for the next couple of months at that average sale price around 380. And here's why. This is taking a look at a chart comparing the last year's average sales price per month in our area. That's the lighter blue in the background there. And then the darker blue shows you where we are at this year and where we've been. And you can see typically on that May, June, July, August, we start to level off. And then as we hit September and the rest of the year, we start to trend downward with what that average sale price is. And so that's kind of what we're expecting. Again, this year, this chart looks pretty similar in terms of those curves every single year. So just again, we talked about this last time, as these are kind of the peak months for the highest sales prices. So if you have anybody on the fence, this could be a good chart, or the one we showed last week or last month, sorry, to help them understand that, hey, we might want to make a move if you're really on the fence about selling right now and get it up sooner rather than later. These are kind of the peak months for getting the highest return on your home. Okay. All right. Here's what we're looking at for number of homes sold per month. And so you can, again, see how our season typically goes. Light blue is last year, and then what we've seen so far this year. We had that nice spike in March. Does anybody remember what happened just a little bit before in February there? Had to do with rates. Yeah, they all went down. We went from a little over 7 down to right around 6, right? And so we saw a nice spike there. And we're going to touch more on some expectations for rates and some forecasts from experts out there, so you guys can plan ahead too based on that and start to get ready for it. So, and then if we look at kind of what we're projecting for sales coming down the pipeline, it is going to be less than last year. And there's a reason we're showing this, is because we want to start talking about, okay, how are we preparing for some of those months, the October, the November, and then January and February, and how do we start preparing for that now? So hopefully some of these things are helpful. We just want you to get a good idea of where we're at. And the big thing is, for when we're planning for those fall and winter months, what we want to be doing right now is, since our market is slower, there's less sales out there. We need to be in touch with more people. We need to be interacting with more people, and we need to be adding more people to our database and our marketing campaign. And we've talked about these numbers before, but here's the quick math. So since we're down about 18% in overall sales, if you were just marketing to 300 people, say in your sphere, for example, in order to do the same amount of business from that group and drive the same amount of business from your sphere, we're gonna have to take that number and we're gonna have to add more people. So if we're down 18%, we have to take the 300 and divide it by 0.82. So we're only seeing 82% of the overall deals, and that's why we're dividing it by that number. So that tells us we really need to find 365 people to add to. So we want to be adding more people to our database. Does anybody here, as one of their goals, have a certain amount of people that they want to add to their database, like every week, every month? Does anybody track those things? Anybody online? Not a single person. No. Tyler's been doing it good. Hopefully he's on there.
We are too.
Good. All right. Cheryl's doing it too. Perfect. That is such a key thing to do. Now, Cheryl, since you spoke up, do you guys, when you, oh no, yeah. Since, do you have a, so when you meet somebody that you want to put in your database and continue to add to, does your team, or do you have a process for how you kind of onboard them or start to ingrain them into your systems?
Yes. Okay. So we meet them, we bring them immediately into a seance. We do those nightly here at my house. It seems to work. By the time they leave, they've decided we're the only team they can work with.
Seances at your house nightly. That's wonderful. No. That's great.
No. What we do is, as soon as we meet someone, that information goes to Chelsea. Chelsea puts it in the database, and then they're on our touch campaign. And Chelsea knows that schedule better than me, but it's at least a monthly touch. It's more than that, because then we have our phone calls, we have our newsletters, we have our emails, all those things. So actually, I think we do it twice a month. And then phone calls on top of that. So that's our system.
Perfect. And so just for all you guys here, because I know it's kind of hard to hear just off of my computer. So Chelsea is there, basically the team manager. She takes all of that on, gets them into their database. They have multiple touches per month that they start ingraining them into their systems and really try to make sure that they capture them and become their go-to agent. And so the reason why we bring that up, and I hope others have similar processes, and you guys can, I can slide that over. I think you can still get it. This is one of the resources in the chat. And this is just an example. So when you take a look at the studies out there, they say that really people only have room for 1 to 2 real estate agents in their mind. Like that's just all the mind share they're willing to give to real estate agents. And we want to make sure we're one of those two, right? And when you look at it, it's actually heavily weighted towards one over the second one. And so we'd love to be in that first position. And really the way to do that, and this has been proven by multiple studies out there, is a consistent onboarding program of 8 to really 10 weeks of touch points every single week for 8 to 10 weeks in a row. And those can be multiple different types of touch points, so they don't always have to be the same thing. In fact, we suggest that it's a combination of multiple things. An introduction letter, it can be emails in there, it can be text messages, phone calls in there, even some small gifts along the way or combination of such for those, that period of time. And that over that 8 to 10 week period is really gonna ingrain you as that top agent in their mind. And from there, move them on to your more regular client appreciation program where doesn't have to be as often, but that's really gonna solidify you as their person. So this is just an example of what one of those could look like. Obviously be creative, you can make it your own, or maybe it'll give you some ideas of what to do. But if you have that goal to add people, and I highly recommend shoot for 2 people a week and then put together a system like this to really become that top agent in their mind. And that'll help prepare you for those fall and winter months, because even though those are slower times of the year, there's some good things coming in We'll talk about those. So there's some light at the end of the tunnel with everything that we're dealing with out there. And that's why you want to get on this process now of adding people. All right. I'm going to keep moving along just for the sake of time and keep, but hopefully you guys can find that useful and ingrain it in some of your systems. Keep moving forward. All right. The other thing that we wanted to talk about today is who's moving? Who are those people that are motivated to sell right now? Because we saw the numbers, not nearly as many of them are, right? Anybody online or anybody here in the room, if you had a resource that told you exactly what a profile of the most common seller, the most common buyer, how they interact with their agents, the experience they've had with their agents, where they found their agents in the past, the reasons why they move, would that be a show of hands? Would that be a document that you would like or something that you would find helpful or useful? I see lots of head nodding from other people. Okay, that's great. Well, because for the last 41 years, we've had that document every single year, and it's updated every single year because NAR puts together a profile of buyers and sellers across the country. Now, it's a several hundred page document, so it's very detailed, but luckily they give us a nice summary as well. So they haven't come out with the 2023 one yet, typically releases in November, but we can take a look back and pull some of that information. So really quick, got just some highlights here for you, and we'll get you the summary of the document as well. And we're gonna hit some of these things. So you can start to think about, okay, how am I gonna target some of these people? Maybe how do I need to change my messaging so it's relevant for the people out there that are motivated right now, because that's who we need to find more than anybody else. All right. Paul, any guess how old the typical seller was or is at the moment or the last? Ooh, I'm just going to give it to you because that's what it was the year before. So the typical home seller, 60 years old, it was 56, and that's getting that age is growing. Anybody guess on, Rebecca, guess on the top reason why people have sold are selling their home? That's a good guess. Moving out of state. Any other guesses? Jeff, I see you thinking. Downsizing, okay. Anybody online?
Moving to live near the grandchildren.
There you go. You got it. This goes moving closer to friends and family. 21% of all people will move because of that, which is a good connection because, yeah, the 60-year-old age, chances are they have some grandchildren, right? Okay, number two, again, with that 60-year-old age being the average retirement, so looking for that place. And then the next one is neighborhood became less desirable. So that's something also, too, that you can kind of start to look if you're looking at farming areas is what neighborhoods do you see changes in? And are you making sure that you're marketing to those areas? So that's just another idea out there of trying to find the motivated. Okay. Now, this is some about sellers and their connections with agents. So I'm going to give you the first one. So 63% of sellers found their agent from a referral from who?
Friend or family?
Friend, family. Ooh, coworker is a good one. That's not in here, but friend, neighbor, and relative. So those are the top three, but I'm sure coworkers up there too. All right. 80% of recent sellers contacted how many agents before finding the right agents to work with? KG got it in the room here. The answer is one agent before. So what did that tell you? You get that appointment, you get that first at bat, you're batting the 800 just by it being the first one in the door. Okay. All right. I'm going to give you the first part of this one and see if you can guess this. So 27% of sellers, this is why you want to stay in touch with your clients, right? 27% of sellers recommended their agent how many times since selling their home on average. Ooh, I wish it was seven, but that's a good guess. Four, KG's on fire, and we're gonna have to get Tim some Robux. It is, it's four or more times. So now the other great thing is that 85% have recommended you at least once. Now the goal too is, how do you find, make sure you're tracking and identifying those 27%, because those are your most valuable people in your database, right? So they, if they've done it four times, they're gonna do it more. All right, and then just to round this out, thanks for playing along, everybody, and your participation, and I appreciate the guesses. This document here, if you download it, it's on the resource sheet, or if you grab it here, this is going to give a lot more other reasons, just those life changes to keep an eye out for, whether it's on social media, whether it's tracking people in your first app, whether it's just paying attention to what's going on in other people's lives, the reasons why people are moving, those life-changing events, because right now that's who's moving in our market. Those are the people who are motivated to move, not because right now it's not financial reasons, right? Because it doesn't make as much financial sense with where rates are, but there's lots of other lifestyle reasons or life change reasons of why people are moving. So this is a great document to download to help you identify those motivated people, and then make sure your messaging, whatever you're doing to market, is relevant to them, and then make sure whatever your delivery message of getting that message to them is getting to the right people. Okay, and then the final, and the reason we bring that all up is that's all just in preparation for, we know some good things are coming. We're going to talk about that, and we want you to be preparing for that now. Now is also the time to be thinking about, okay, what are my client gifts, or who does a client appreciation program? And Rebecca, you do any client appreciation program or events, anything like that, ramping up? So anybody Sarah else? All right, Sarah, what do you do for an event?
I usually host either a slip and slide party or a bonfire. Do slip and slide in the summer and then bonfire party at night.
Fantastic, that's a great event. Cheryl, what do you said you do a client event too?
Mute. We just had the premiere of Little Mermaid, which was awesome. And We have actresses that play the characters and meet the kids. And then we, of course, pay for the movie theater, and it was packed. And then popcorn and sodas and prizes. So that was our spring event. We have summer, fall events as well.
Wonderful. No, perfect event. Very timely. Very big release of a movie. I even heard a news story on the radio where evidently there's a company that makes mermaid suits who's having a great year based off of that too. Actually, if you want, if anybody's got an extra $50,000, you can get their very high-end mermaid suit evidently. So yeah, did you hear that on the radio? Yeah, it's crazy. So here's some other ideas. Those are great ideas. Talk to the rest of your colleagues. We just like to provide this to start thinking about it, because they take some planning. And then also, whether it's just pop by gifts too for the rest of the summer, or start thinking about fall really now is a good idea, or end of summer, or maybe it's before school starts. Great little school pack, you know, back to school packages are great ideas for clients out there. And so things to think about now, and we'll have the fall and winter one out soon. So grab this and just start planning ahead. One of the things that we can do to help, and I know it's already this weekend, but they've been at the office for a while. If you just want to send out some, you know, if you did some Mother's Day cards, you want to make sure you do some Father's Day cards. These are available at the office already. You can send them just as postcards, or we have envelopes too. So a great touch point as well, a really easy one throughout the year. So you can grab those. Okay. Thank you again, everybody, for sharing. Let's get to some information, because we promised some updates on rates and some projections on what's going forward. And so this is some of the the surprising, get to deliver some good news about rates, because these are some positive projections. And these are some things, if you're getting questions from people out there in the market, we want you to be able to to answer these and speak to them, right? And know what's coming down the line, because it could line you up for future sales. All right. And of course you can't see the number and I can't see how to pull this out of the way. There we go. All right. So number one, so, and this is from the Mortgage Brokers Association. So they're expecting rates by the end of the year to drop lower and closer to 5.5. That sounds pretty good, right? Yeah. We saw the little spike in the market back in March, right? When we hit 6%. That sounds pretty good. Okay, this is from NAR. So they're thinking progressively falling to around 6 by the end of this year and 5.6 in 2024. Bank of America, they're the they're really positive on it. They're hoping for 5.5 and a quarter by year end. And just so you know, all this information is taken just from a couple of days ago. So late last week is when all of these projections were coming out. And then Freddie Mac, and you guys can see that here. They're again expecting rates to decelerate and decline over the course of 2023 as the rate of inflation is coming down. And I put that one last because that's a good segue into what's going on with inflation and also some of the reasons for these more positive outlooks on rates. So on inflation, yeah.
Would you mind that last slide? I want to snap a picture of that. Is that possible?
Yeah, it can get you a picture of that. We can send out a picture of that for sure. Let's see if they, oh, I don't want to annotate.
I can also just send out the presentation.
Perfect.
Yeah, that'll
work. Hold on, I'm going to have to escape out of this just for a second because I can't see my mouse. Oh, because it thinks I want to draw.
I could get it from Kayla later, so that should be a problem.
Yeah, I'm not trying to get it the rates up. I'm just trying to get my computer to reset.
Oh.
You have a hammer? That's good. Huh. It was a... like an expert who knows how to just get out of the, that's what I'm doing. Yeah, I pressed it about 10 times. Yeah, I know, that's the best I can think of. Well, I can do the rest without going through it because I know what the numbers are on inflation, but you guys will probably want those slides too. So at the end of April, so, well, let's just start. Inflation was up, you know, 11% or whatever, CPI, all of that. So we've been working hard. The Fed has, with all these changes, to try to get it down. At the end of April, we were down to 4.9%, which is great. A few days ago, late last week, the expectations was, the report was saying that we'd be about 4.6 at the end of May. Now, just yesterday, they released the actual numbers. Anybody got a guess on where we came in? Yeah, Leandra's got it in the back. So we came down actually lower than what they were expecting and it came in at 4%. So that's fantastic news on rates. Now it's still, you know, double what the Fed's goal is of 2%, but coming down from 11% down to 4%, it shows, you know, great progress. And hopefully it'll mean the Fed will stay very conservative with their changes because they can see the progress that's already been happening out there in the market. And that trend line isn't just going to all of a sudden spike back up, or we're going to see that continue to go down. So that's fantastic news. And that's also the reason for, I think, a lot of those positive interest rate projections. So use that information when you're out there talking with people. And that's, again, the kind of the light at the end of the tunnel. And that's why we also want to be ingraining more people into our database, into our systems, and preparing for, hey, we see this coming. I'd love to have more people in my database now and start that process so that when the market more opens up because of all these changes, you're in a great position to grab more market share. Makes sense. Okay. That's unfortunately, sorry, I can't show it. That's everything we have on those updates. And then I have a real quick few GRAR updates, but any other questions around any of that information? Is that helpful for people? One, just to get assigned good information to be able to share and talk about, give an idea where the market's going.
Yeah. All right. Good question, Dave. When you talk about people in the database, what do you do with comments? Do you comment with one or
two? Cool. That's a great one. I would count them as one unit for, yeah, because they're a couple in the same housing unit. Now it's great from the standpoint of, you know, they may have two different workplaces. They may be two different people to refer you out. But I would rather err on the side of considering a lower amount in my database than a higher, just so I don't kind of inflate some of those things in my. Good question. So I don't know if everybody heard, but KG asked if to consider a couple, one or two people in your database that you're marketing to. All right. Let's very quickly cover some GRAR updates. I want to highlight these and make sure you guys can go and check the documents, and we'll make sure we include it in the summary so that you get all the details. Number one, if you haven't heard about it, there's been a lot of vacant land scam situations or attempts out there. GRAR's put out some messaging about it. It's been in the newsletter multiple times. They sent out some separate emails and they gave some great suggestions about how to try to verify ownership and just make sure that you're going through that process. So critical to do that. These scammers are very clever, but we want to make sure that we are working with the actual owner of the property, and they're specifically targeting vacant land. So make sure that you're doing your due diligence on checking that you have and that you're working with the correct owner. There has been an instance where it actually got all the way through title, closed, and money paid out, and that's a very bad thing, and you don't want to be in that situation or have anybody else, a buyer, be in that situation, right? So pay attention to that thing, and wanted to again just highlight it from our end as well. The next thing, and this is a question that's come up, and there's in the June 5th GRAR weekly update, there's a great write-up about it, but somebody asked about if it's okay for a agent from a different brokerage to host an open house for you or to show a property for you. And there are some definite reasons why not to do that. And just a few, and the letter of the law actually from the Michigan Realtors came out with a video about all of those things. And so that's not allowed legally at all without broker consent. So that's a Michigan state law. It's also a real challenge when it comes to agency and disclosure, as well as it can really get you in some challenges with E&O insurance and whether or not you're covered and whether or not our policy covers you. And then also it comes a challenge if there is property damage or injury that occurs during that showing or during that situation. Because again, rolls back to the liability and which brokerage is really getting wrapped into that. And then there's some real challenges with procuring cause and the chances that you may start causing some issues with or challenges with that, especially if that particular client or whoever it is becomes really well connected with that other agent. So again, not something that we want to be doing. We can leverage field services. We can leverage all the many other agents out there. And then there's a great link in here to the video in that update of all the reasons why it puts you at risk, and why it puts the brokerage at risk, and also the legalities around why it would require a broker consent in order to do that. So just wanted to make sure everybody was clear on that situation. I can't say I know of any of that happening within our brokerage, but didn't want any questions around that. And then the final thing is around letters from buyers to sellers, and just reiterating, because evidently there's still been a lot of those going around, but reiterating the change that happened again in all the documentations, and that those are no longer an option. Those are no longer something that can be written or sent on the behalf of your buyer. So then that's, you know, association wide. And there's just too many risks on the fair housing situation. And so the decision's just been made that those things are eliminated. And so remember that when you're out there in the market as well. And if you need to reference anything from GRAR on that, or any questions on that, or if your buyers have questions on that, again, you can just be able to state that that's something that's no longer allowed in our association to do. And hopefully that helps you with that conversation as well. Okay. Lastly, and I think it's in the links too, Kelsey figured out a much easier way other than contacting Applied Imaging to help connect to printers and printers at other offices and put together a really simple and easy document. You can download it in the chat, and it should make things a whole lot simpler and easier. And unfortunately for Kelsey, but since you're the one who discovered it, then it's, you might get the calls or the emails if somebody needs some help with that or needs to re-up at one of the other offices for some reason. But make sure you grab that and download that. We also have some great events coming up in the near future, so pay attention to those throughout the summertime. And we're looking forward to spending time with more of you. So more information, just keep on paying attention to your Monday emails. And any questions before we wrap up today? And I apologize for keeping you a little longer than a half hour. Hopefully it was worth it. Silence.
Thanks.
Thanks so much, everybody. It's good to see you. Glad you could make it, and good luck out there.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I may never be able to exit this screen. Thank you.